desperation. When all we know is doubt and fear. There is only one foundation. We believe. We believe. We believe in God the Father. We believe in Jesus Christ. We believe in the Holy Spirit, and He's given us new life. We believe in the crucifixion. We believe that He conquered death. We believe in the resurrection, and He's coming back again. We believe. So temptations, we believe. We believe. We believe in God the Father.
dream has died. Like a tree planted by the water, we never will run dry. So living water flowing through, God, we thirst for more of you. Fill our hearts and flood our souls with one desire, just to know. To show them who you are. So living water flowing through, God, we thirst for more of you. Fill our hearts and flood our souls with one desire, just to
God, why don't you do something? Amen.
Well, good morning. Let's turn and greet somebody next to you and let them know that you're glad that they're here. Well, good morning. Welcome to Independence First Church of the Nazarene. You may be seated.
Oh, yeah.
It's good to see everybody this morning.
Oh, yeah. It's a good day today.
Anyway, how many of you guys blew in? I'm just thinking, yeah, if I could put a sail on my car, I could save on some gas. But anyway, we're glad that you're here with us this morning. A few announcements that we have. For you, coming up this week, our Cuff Meal. So if you would like to help with that, there's sign-up sheets out in the foyer on the welcome desk over on this side. And you sign up there and help us out. Or if you'd like to come and be a part of that at the Wesley Center on Thursday, you can get with Avery in the office. She'll give you more details and be a part of that coming up. Also, on April 28th, that's in 2 weeks from right now. We're going to have breakfast for lunch again. Ooh. Yeah. And I don't know. I wanted hash, but Emmy says maybe it's pancakes. I don't know.
Emmy, come on.
Wait. So come and be a part of that. And if you want to bring stuff to help for breakfast, come. We'll provide the main entree, but if you bring the steps there, and then we'll just have lunch together and a good time of fellowship. So come and be a part of that. Also coming up on May 5th, May 5th is the beginning of our church year. We'll have our end of the year report on Sunday morning. I'll be giving the pastor's report for last year, and then May 5th in the evening. The staff will be giving their reports, and we're going to do that in the Family Life Center, and you can bring finger foods, and we'll just enjoy a time of fellowship there and just hear what God has been doing in our church, and then see what we plan on doing in the next year. And so, and some of you might think, hey, what does all that entail? We also will begin voting on May 5th for our church board and some of our committees. And so we'll do that on May 5th, and then again the next Sunday. If you are not a member of the church and you would like to become a member, or maybe you would just like to get to know a little bit more about our church, we're starting the About Our Church class. It runs for 3 weeks, so it'll be the next 2 weeks, and then on May 5th we'll finish up. And if you take that or have taken it in the past and want to become a member, we'll take you in. And then you can vote. Isn't that exciting?
Oh, yeah.
And listen, we're running a special on membership right now. There is no charge.
No charge.
No membership fee to sign up and to become a member. And so, yeah. Anyway, exciting. And we'll let you help with VBS.
Hey, yeah, absolutely. We were going to let you help out with VBS before, but, you know, just, we'll give you a crisp high five. But we have Vacation Bible School coming up. How many of you are excited about Vacation Bible School?
Woo!
Oh, yeah. It's going to be a blast. This year's theme is Let's Start the Party. And what better way to kick off the summer than to do it in Jesus' name? Amen?
Amen.
Now, that's going to be May 27th through the 31st from 6 o'clock to 8:30. We will feed you, all right? We
are
in a high belief to feed the masses and everything. We have signups. If last year we had over 60 people that wanted to help out at Vacation Bible School, and I promise you something, for everybody that showed up, the kids also responded. So if you show up, kids are also going to show up. And this year, I'm setting the goal just to see, is that could we as a church have 75 individuals helping out at Vacation Bible School?
Woo!
Can
That'd be awesome.
Because here's the thing, we have sign-up sheets right out there. We have a few signed up, but don't believe that I will just assume that you will be there, okay? If you will, please sign up. We have all sorts of different areas out there to sign up for, such as crafts and games and being a leader and things like that. And there's even one board that says, I don't know, but put me somewhere. Sign up for that if you have no clue what you want to do, all right? And God willing, we will put you in the right spot, all right? That's going to happen on May 27th through the 31st. We would love for you to be a part of that. Also, how many of you guys are just kind of slightly competitive? Raise your hand if you're slightly competitive. There they are. Those are the competitive ones. And then everybody else was lying because they are competitive. You're in church. It's a good place to be. All right. So we have Putt-Putt coming up, and that's going to be starting on June 5th.
Yeah.
And for each Wednesday through June and July, if you sign up for $25 per person, or if you get a group to sign up, four or more, that'll just be $20 a person, and you get a free t-shirt. Well, you get a t-shirt because you pay. You get a t-shirt and a summer's worth of golf, and it is so much fun. We're going to keep scores, and at the end of the summer, on the first Wednesday of August, we're going to have a putt-putt celebration and give out all sorts of silly awards and things like that. But it's a great way for families to get together and grandparents to get with grandchildren and everything. So come and join us. We would love to join you in time of fellowship, and all the money that we raise goes to kids' camps and retreats.
Yeah, that's exciting.
Oh, yeah. And if you beat my score that week, I might give you a popsicle. We'll see.
If they beat my score.
That'll be pretty easy.
Yeah, that's easy.
Yeah.
Anyway, so, well, just thank you and come and be a part of it and everything we have going on. At this time, let's just stand and continue worshiping and praise God.
Into marvelous light I'm running, out of darkness and out of shame. By the cross you are the truth, you are.
I once was fatherless, unsung.
seated here as we get ready for a time of prayer and before we get ready to take up our morning tithes and offering. Ooh, shout to the Lord. Man, how powerful that is, and that we have a place such as this, that we have a stage such as this, that we were selected, we were chosen to live in such a time as these. I encourage you that this would be the song of your week. Shout to the Lord. Let all of creation hear. Jesus said that when the children were singing his praises as they were as he was marching into Jerusalem, that if the children didn't sing, that the rocks would cry out. I don't want to give the rocks excuses to have worship louder than I do. So today, as we bow our heads and pray, may your worship be loud. Not just your singing voices, but the way that you live your life. When you stand up to temptation and you tell it no, that is worship. When you choose Jesus over doing anything else, that's worship. When you reflect him in your everyday life and you show kindness when you shouldn't, when you think you shouldn't, or when the world tells you you shouldn't, that's how you worship. So right now, as we get ready to pray, worship. Worship with the intent that you're going to glorify and honor God right now. Will you bow your heads and pray with me? Dear Heavenly Father, thank you so much for today. Lord, thank you for the reminder of your name and just how powerful it really is. That, Lord, that at your name, the demons, they quake in fear. That at the mention of your name, you can send one mountain from one side to the other. That, Lord, at the mention of your name, that all things are possible. And so, Lord, we just want to call upon your name. Jesus, speak into our lives. Holy Spirit, have your way. Father, reveal yourself to us. May we have a moment that when Thomas needed to see the holes in your hand and the hole in your side, that, Lord, that you revealed yourself to him. You knew exactly what he needed for him to believe. And, Lord, you know exactly what we need in order that we would believe. And so, Lord, I pray that you would sustain us, that, Lord, that you would bless us. I pray over Pastor Bill, Lord, that today you would bless his lips. You would touch his tongue, Lord, that today he would preach holy. And that, Lord, that we would have ears that are ready to receive such things. And that, Lord, we wouldn't hide ourselves from you. Lord, I pray that your word is spoken. I pray that we are ready. And that church, and I pray that our church would be set on fire for you, Lord. To love you authentically, to love you with purpose, with intentionality and integrity, Lord. May we bless you as much as you have blessed us. It's in your holy name we pray. Amen. Well, church, our ushers are going to come forward and take our morning tithes and offering, and then we'll move on.
Amen. It's good to be with you again this morning. Before I get into the message, I just have to tell you about our weekend that we had last weekend. We went to Young Christians Weekend at Branson, Silver Dollar City, and I think it's our 15th year. There was a year in there with COVID and some different things, but taking kids there. And you know what I found out this year? Something new. I'm not young anymore. And going up and down that hill at Silver Dollar City is harder. It got steeper this year. I'm not sure what they did. Emmy would not let me rent one of those little carts, and so I had to walk up and down, and I spent a lot of time in the rocking chair up at the top listening to music. But we had a great time with our teens, and one of the things that we like to do is on our way home on Sunday, we go to church in Springfield, and we were at the well, and it was their celebration Sunday. They did baptisms and took in new members and baby dedications, and I'd let them know early that we're coming, and there was about 27 of us, and they were going to save us a place to sit in their third service. And we got there, and they had been busy. Of course, there's a lot going on, and they hadn't saved us a place. So we're scrambling and getting places to sit. And we got to sit right in front of the sound booth. Their sound booth is on the bottom floor, right in the back, and we sat right in front of it. So if you watch their live stream and you see a bright light underneath the camera, that was the light shining off the top of my head, because that's right where I was at. And we're sitting there, and they're bringing people in, and they're sitting with us. And a couple gentlemen sat next to us, and the guy right next to me was in a wheelchair, handicapped, and he was sitting there. And the guy sitting next to him that was with him wasn't in a wheelchair, but probably had some disabilities and things. And he would talk during the service. You know, it had things to do, but I was listening to him, and they got ready to start baptizing people. Now, they total through their three services, they baptized 54 people. In our service, they did probably close to 40. I didn't count, but there was about that many. So they're bringing them in, and they're going through them, you know, and baptizing them. And he kept saying, I'll go first. I want to go first. And I realized what he was saying was, I want to go. I want to be baptized. I want to go next. I want to be the one. And he just kept talking to the guy next to him, and the guy next to him was like, okay, you know, and he's chatting with him. And Selena, the pastor, happened to be in the back. There were other people that were doing the baptisms, and she was just kind of back there helping coordinate, and she chatted with the man and some people that were there chatted with him, and I just realized he wants to be baptized. And right at the end, they come and they get Tim and they take him up front and they baptize him, and it was just amazing. And I told Selena afterwards, I said, that's awesome. And she said, well, you know, God knows, and I'm not gonna say no. And I said, well, that's good, because if you were gonna say no, I was going to call for somebody to bring me a bottle of water or something, and I was going to baptize that man. He wanted to be baptized, and we were going to get it done. But that was just exciting, and I think it was exciting for us to see that God is on the move, and he is not willing that any should perish, but that all would have eternal life through him. And so it was just exciting. So I've been thinking about this, what if. I talked to some people and said, hey, what's a series or something I can do? And what if? And today I came up with, what if I get angry? Now, I know that some of you are like, well, Pastor Bill, I never get angry. I never lose my temper. And next week, we will preach on what if I lie. Not really. But what if I get angry? And this morning, I came in, and I usually have my framework and everything of my sermon. But on Sunday mornings, I kind of do some rearrangement sometimes, and then I get my slides ready for service, and it never fails. Okay, last night we had a group that came in from Potter's House, and we chatted with them, and I had my computer set up and everything worked great, and I shut it down, and I came back in this morning, and it wouldn't connect to my monitor. Well, I have to have my monitor because God is helping my eyes, but I still can't see a monitor that's this big. And so I messed with that, and I finally got it, and I have a program that I use, and I'm trying to type in some scriptures, and all of a sudden, the program just wouldn't let me edit and type. And I'm noticing as I'm typing, I'm getting a little more forceful with hitting the buttons. And it just hit me, don't be angry. It's not the computer's fault. It was the computer's fault, but there's nothing beating on the keyboard was going to do about getting angry. And something that you may not know about me is I can get angry sometimes. I thought I'd hear more amens from over here. I could get angry. I remember back in fifth grade, I went to the Bible school here, and my fifth grade teacher and I wouldn't say that we didn't get along, but she could make me angry. And we had these desks. I think I've got a picture up there. Yeah, do you guys remember anybody sitting these desks? Yeah, you're there, and you raise the top of your desk, and that's where your books and your paper and your pencils and everything went. Now, I don't know if any of you have been in to see my desk now. It's not a mess. It's just not strictly organized. Okay, I know which pile things are in, and I know which drawer they're in. And I've always been that way, and my desk in fifth grade got a little messy. I knew where everything was at, you know. I knew where all of those assignments that I hadn't finished were at. They were right there in the desk. And one day, the teacher decided to tell me to clean out my desk. I don't know if there had been some previous communication or what, but all I remember about her telling me to clean out my desk is it made me mad. And so I cleaned out my desk. How I cleaned out my desk is I grabbed that bar that's right down there at the bottom and I dumped it on the floor. Emptied it completely out. It was clean. Now there's a mess on the floor. And then I picked it up and went. Now, that was not right. I was in anger. And I know some of you are laughing, but I'm pretty sure that there are some incidences in your life that you're comparing to. Now, I don't do that now when Emmy and Avery tell me to clean my desk because I can't lift it. But I don't lose my temper like that. But we all become angry. Now, this is the one thing that I have to tell you. Before we go into this, a lot of people tell me, well, Jesus got angry. He cleaned out the temple. He lost his temper. Jesus did not lose his temper. This is a side note, but you have to know this, okay? A couple reasons why I know Jesus did not lose his temper is that he'd been in that temple many, many times. Was he angry? Yes, he was angry, but it wasn't in a fit of rage that Jesus cleaned out the temple and overturned the tables. And Jesus was angry not because of what they were doing, but because they were harming or keeping people from obtaining forgiveness and coming into his presence. That was the only place that the Holy Spirit resided. And that's what made Jesus angry. And so our anger can be good if we use it in the right constructive way. I don't know of any place where you are authorized to go in and start tipping over tables. Okay? Because we all now have free access to the Holy Spirit. The time that you could become angry is when people are harming or keeping people from coming into God's Spirit. So that's just kind of a side note there. So don't bring up to me, well, my fit of rage was justified because Jesus did it. No, it is not. And you can't go into that. So what about anger? Why is anger a problem? Does the Bible say we shouldn't get anger? Because it's a natural emotion for us to feel. But in Psalms 37:8, it says, refrain from anger and turn from wrath. Do not fret. It only leads to evil. It's not saying don't experience it, but it says don't fret. Don't think on it. Don't continue in your anger, because it's only going to lead to bad places. Proverbs 14:17, a quick-tempered person does foolish things, and the one who devises evil schemes is hated. I know you're probably thinking of people, or maybe you're thinking of yourself, who might be quick-tempered. And you, when you're quick to get angry, I don't know about you, but I've looked back and thought, well, that was really silly of me in the way I reacted, or what I said, or what I did when I allowed my anger to be in control. And I was thinking about, as we're looking at this and how we deal with this, is what and who do we become angry at? And I know the first thing that pops into the mind are all the people that have made you angry, right? I mean, quit looking at your neighbor. There's people that make us angry. We also become angry at ourselves, but sometimes it is exhibited to somebody else. And can I say that sometimes we become angry at God? It's okay to become angry with God. Now, I know some of you are nervous at that statement. And we're going to explore that a little bit more. But this is the thing. God knows everything about you. If you're angry at Him, He already knows. There's no sense of trying to pretend like that you're not. And so as we begin to explore, and we're only scratching the surface today, but as we begin to explore this anger and how we deal with it and how we express it, remember that it is okay to be angry. Can I tell you that there's been some times, even recently, that I've asked God for some things and He hasn't done them, and I've been upset and I've been angry. And I tell Him, God, that makes me angry. And He understands that we have some anger. So how do we avoid anger? How do we avoid this? If we know that it leads to some bad things, how do we avoid it? We're not going to totally avoid it, but how do we minimize it a little bit? And so in James 1, verses 19 through 22, my dear brothers and sisters, take note of this. Everyone should be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to become angry, because human anger does not produce the righteousness that God desires. Therefore, get rid of all moral filth and the evil that is so prevalent, and humbly accept the word planted in you, which can save you. Do not merely listen to the word and so deceive yourself, but do what it says. Now this is pretty strong, right? Don't just listen to the word, but do what it says. I don't know about you, but I've been to a lot of trainings where I've heard how to do things. This is how you interview people. This is how you do this. This is how you do that. And most of the time when I come back from those trainings, there's about 1, 2, maybe 3 things that stick out in my mind, and the rest of it, I don't remember. And I might go back to my book and look through it, but probably not. And this is what the Word is saying. The Word is saying, listen, it said, accept the Word that's planted in you, and don't just listen to it, but do what it says. It's not going to do you any good to come to church and hear what I have to say or what God's saying through the Word. It doesn't even do you any good to read the word but not do what it says. It's just a book at that point. And if we don't do what God's word says, we're not going to be effective. And so if we're worried and we want to minimize our anger and not live in a fit of rage and in temper, we have to do what God's word says. And the first thing it says is quick to listen. This is not something that comes normal to people. I used to say to some people, and the more I get to know people, it doesn't come quick to anybody. Most of us are not really listening, and you've probably heard this before. Most of us are waiting to say something in a conversation. You're not listening to what other people are saying. You're waiting to respond. You hear one little thing and you just want to jump in and respond to it or compare. But the Bible is saying listen to other people. And a lot of times if we will listen to what people are really trying to communicate to us, we don't get as angry. Many times when I was getting angry with other people is because I wasn't listening to what they had to tell me and what they were trying to communicate. And sometimes they don't even know what they're trying to communicate. They're just talking. And so it really takes us some time to listen and to try to figure out where they're coming from. And when we begin to do that, and slow to speak. Wow. Somebody said in the back, they wore their open-toe shoes because they knew they were going to get their toes stepped on this morning. Every time I read this, I hear it, then am I really doing it? Because I have a lot of good advice to give people. I have a lot of good advice to tell you and to explain to you. My kids can tell you I have a lot of good advice. And I want to share it with you. And sometimes I share things that are not helpful because I didn't listen. And sometimes I'm too quick to speak. And we're too quick to speak. And even, and this is hard for me to say, even if we have the answer, it may not be the right time to give the answer. I don't know that I've learned that yet. Because one of the things that makes us angry, or makes me angry, is when people don't listen to me. Well, maybe I should just quit talking. And maybe I wouldn't get as angry if I wasn't speaking so much. And it's slow to anger. And what does that indicate to us? That indicates to us that we have a measure of control over our anger. I have people that tell me, I can't control my anger. I just can't do it. Yes, you can. You just don't want to. I know that because I've been there. Sometimes it just feels better to let it go and let it fly. But what happens is we begin to get ourselves in trouble and we have to control ourselves. Everything that the Bible is teaching us is about control. And sometimes, even if we don't have control, we've got to allow the Spirit to have control. And the Spirit will tell us when it's time to keep our mouth shut and when it's not, if we'll listen. And if we'll follow him. And this is the other thing that it's saying in here is not only do we have to be slow to speak and slow to anger, but there's some other things that have to come along in here. And we have to get rid of the filth and the junk that allows anger to breed within us. Now, this is something that I hadn't really paid attention until I started researching this. We throw out the slow to speak and the quick to listen a lot. But we don't realize that Paul is still saying, and he says right in here, get rid of the filth, the moral filth, and the evil that is prevalent. So that means that there is some moral things in our life that we need to do, because if we don't, that is beginning to allow anger to build up in us. I've said this before. It's been a couple years ago when YouTube and all of them started coming out with the shorts or reels, or, you know, even TikTok. TikTok's evil. It's really not. Just there's some things on it that's evil, but they're short. I like them because I don't like things that are long. I get bored. And the older I get, the more ADD I am, I think, and I don't watch them. And so I would, you know, scroll through YouTube and you start watching these things. And I like to watch the police videos, right? You know, you just watch them and they're fun. And I realized that my attitude and my anger was getting worse. And I realized through prayer that it was some of the videos that I was watching was irritating me. It didn't have anything to do with me, but I'm watching them and they were starting to irritate me. And I began to allow that into my mind, and it was coming out in other areas. See, it does make a difference in what we put into our minds as to what comes out. And if we're allowing moral filth into our mind, and I know you're thinking, oh, Pastor, I would never watch moral filth. Well, how much dirt does it take to make something dirty? How much? I use the excuse that I can't see, but my wife tells me there's always, when I clean, there's always one thing I forget. And to me, I'm like, it's a big deal. I left one cup out. Well, to her, it's still dirty. And I feel like that in our minds, we're starting to allow things into our hearts that God is saying that's still dirty. It's still not good. And how much are you going to allow into your life? And this isn't me. This is the Word of God. It doesn't say don't allow angry things into your life. It says get rid of all moral filth. All of it. And I know in our lives, we go back through, and now you can pretty much watch anything, right? As long as you have somebody's login and password to Hulu, Peacock, Paramount, whatever, you can watch anything. And we started watching some things, and we get a little bit into it, and we're like, I don't want to watch that anymore. I don't want to. That's got some things that I just don't want to put into my mind, into my heart anymore. And God is saying, don't allow Satan to allow some things into your life, because it's a breeding ground for anger. And then it says the things that are so prevalent, the attitudes and the things of the world. And what has happened is the church has allowed the attitudes of the world to become such a part of us that we're responding, even with the truth of God, in anger. I don't know about you, but it doesn't take long for you to start looking at dialogues, Facebook, forums, to see that Christians are now responding back in anger because we're allowing the attitude of the world to become a part of us. And people tell me, well, listen, I'm just protecting the Word of God. The Word of God does not need our protection. God doesn't need us to stand up for Him in that aspect in an angry manner. We just need to stand up for truth. And we're responding back to the world in an angry manner, and we're becoming deceived because we're not doing what the Word of God tells us to do. Another way that we avoid anger, 2 Timothy 2:23 through 25, and these are the words of God straight out of the Bible. Don't have anything to do with foolish and stupid arguments. Can I reread that? Don't have anything to do with foolish and stupid arguments, because you know they produce quarrels. And the Lord's servant must not be quarrelsome, but be kind to everyone, able to teach and not resentful. Opponents must be gently instructed in the hope that God will restore them, or will grant them repentance, leading them to a knowledge of the truth. Listen, if you can't keep from arguing with people on Facebook, delete Facebook. It's God's word. We're getting so wound up in foolish and stupid arguments that it says it creates quarrels. And I know, listen, I'm hitting myself square in the face. You know how many times I've argued with somebody who did not know what they... And maybe they were on drugs, or maybe they were... And I'm trying to argue with them. And you know what it creates? It creates strife. And then I get angry. And they get angry, and nothing happens. You don't have to make people think like you do. Live the truth. And I look around, and we wonder why people are so angry anymore. It's because we're trying to argue over foolish things. And it's just not working. And so it leads us to the point, but what if I do get angry? And this is not, but what if I do get angry? This is when I get angry, because we are going to have some anger. So some of you might already be angry. What do I do when I get angry? Ephesians 4, 26 through 27 says, in your anger do not sin. Do not let the sun go down on you while you're still angry, and do not give the devil a foothold. Because when we become angry and we're allowing anger to control us, we're opening ourselves up to Satan. And he begins to push us, and he begins to push our buttons, and he begins to tell us that we are justified in what we're doing because we're angry. And when that happens, we become sinful. Remember I said, well, what if I'm angry with somebody else? Okay, you're angry with them, okay? But you're going to have to deal with that anger. And I don't mean go punch them. That would be sinful. What I mean is you're going to have to figure it out. You're going to have to deal with the anger and not let it control you. We understand that anger is a secondary emotion. It's usually driven by another emotion. And we're going to have to figure out what that is. And what is driving that emotion? Sometimes it's because we're hurt. or we're embarrassed, and we're responding out of that hurt, and we're responding out of that embarrassment. And because we're hurt, we want somebody else to hurt also. And what happens is, okay, you hurt me a little bit, and so I want to hurt you back, but it's not just enough. Satan is pushing me because I'm letting anger control me, and it's not just enough, so I want to hurt you a little bit more. And then you want to hurt me back a little bit more, and not only do you want to hurt me, you want to hurt the people around me. And as we begin to let that control us, that's when we open ourselves up to sin. And we're talking about if we're angry with God. Listen, you got to be careful. I said it's okay to be angry with God, and it is okay to say, God, this situation is angry, but you got to be really, really careful when you're angry with God that you don't allow that to overturn or overrun you, and in that case, become sinful and become disrespectful to God. See, it's okay to tell him I'm angry, but it's not okay to begin to blame him. Because a lot of times we're in a situation because we live in a sinful world. You know, you're saying, Pastor, you're saying that because I sinned, this is why I'm going through whatever. No, I'm saying because we live in a sinful world. Things are going to happen. Bad things are going to happen. Next week, we're going to talk about what if I don't get healed. And we're going to talk about healing. And sometimes we see that it's not our fault. Maybe it's somebody else. But it's because of a sinful world, and we can't blame God. Sometimes it's because our ego is bruised. Let's just be honest. Okay? I know a lot of times when I was a police officer, and I would get angry and I would lose my temper with somebody else, is because they weren't respecting my authority. Like I had any authority. It wasn't me. I was working under the authority of the agency I worked for. And we as Christians with other people become angry because they're not respecting what we have to say. And it's not about us. It's about God. It's about God. And if God loves them, why can we not? The other thing is, too, sometimes in dealing with anger, we need help. We can't do it on our own. We need professional help. We need to speak to somebody that can help us work through it. It is okay to seek professional help. Did you know that? It is okay. It is not a sign of weakness. It is not a sign that God can't, God can take care of it. I believe that God will heal me. I believe that God can heal my eyes. I believe that God can heal my body. But until then, I'm going to take my medicine like I'm supposed to. I'm going to continue wearing my monitor that alerts my wife. Okay? I'm going to eat the things that she tells me to, because I tried it the other way. It didn't work. Okay? I decided I don't need professional people. God can heal me. And I ate not the whole pie, but most of it. I didn't eat the whole cake that Ralph brought me, but most of it. It didn't work. We need to seek professional help. We need to talk to people. Hey, I can't do this on my own. God, I need some help. Show me who I need to talk to. God, I don't want to, because the last point that we get to, what if I do sin? What if I lose my temper and I sin? I've been there. Because it brings up the emotions in us that God says are not right. Jesus said, listen, you've heard, thou shalt not kill. But I'm telling you, and I think Pastor Chase just spoke on it last week, Sermon on the Mount. But I'm telling you, if you hate somebody, you've committed murder. And if we allow anger to control us, we're going to begin to hate people. And we're going to wish things upon them that are not holy. And we're going to react in ways that we should not react. Even if we're telling the truth, if we're doing it in anger, we're doing it in sin. And what if I sin? Well, you know what you have to do? You have to ask for forgiveness. You have to do it. You have to be sorry, and not sorry that it happened, but sorry enough that you don't want to do it again. And there's been a lot of times that I've had to ask people forgiveness because of what I did in my anger. I've had to ask my kids forgiveness, probably not near enough. Once again, I thought I'd hear more amens. We're going to have to ask forgiveness. Because we've got to get rid of that. We've got to tell people, listen, I treated you in a way that was not right. And I'm sorry. I was angry and I let my anger control me. And not try to excuse our anger. Not try to say, well, you know, you were doing this, this, and this, and so you made me angry and made me sin. No. I'm sorry. Because I wasn't showing you the love of Christ. And you say, but Pastor, I really said some things to God, or at least had thoughts about God that were sinful. I've been angry enough with God that I have sinned. And I've been there too. There have been things in my life that have happened that I don't understand, and I've been so angry with God. But there's an amazing verse in the Bible, and to me, this is just what the love of Christ sums up. I love John 3:16. I love the fact that we read about what God has done for us, but in 1 John 2:1-2, John is writing and he says, my dear children, I write this to you so that you will not sin. But if anybody does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous one. He is the one atoning sacrifice for our sins, and not only for our sins, but for the sins of the whole world. See, God wants to work in your life. He wants to help you control your anger. He's given us tools. But he hasn't given us tools so that we'll be perfect. He's given us tools so that we can be righteous and that we can follow him. But when we don't and when we sin, we have an advocate. The very same Jesus Christ that died for the first atonement of our sin is there for when we fall. Is there for when we're done. And a lot of times we want to hide that. And we think that we have to be perfect. And we think that there is nothing that we can do once we stumble and we fall, because we believe that God can keep us from sinning. Yes, we believe that. But sometimes we do. And we have a choice. We have a choice to ask God for forgiveness and to live in the same freedom that He gave us when He saved us. Or we can go back and live in that bondage of sin. And that's what Satan wants us to do. And we can give up and we can say, well, there's nothing I can do about my anger. And we can let it control us, or we can say, God, I'm sorry. I'm sorry that I let it control me in this situation, but I need your help and I need your forgiveness, and He will do it. I'm going to invite the praise team to come. And as they begin to sing, I don't know, maybe some of you really deal with major anger issues. Maybe some of you just deal with minor, or maybe you don't think that you deal with them at all. And maybe you've realized that, God, I've sinned. In my anger, I have allowed some things into my heart and into my life. Or maybe I have allowed some things in my heart and my life, and it's beginning to breed anger. It's beginning to allow these things into me. God, today I need to ask your forgiveness. And maybe there's some other people that you need to ask their forgiveness. Or you just need to forgive them, so that anger is not controlling you. And listen, I've talked a lot today about us losing our temper, but sometimes we live in this constant thing of anger, and we're not losing control. We're not flying off the handle, so to speak. But we're responding not just to the people who are making us angry, not just to God, but we're responding to everybody in anger. And our attitude is not right, and we need to do this. We need to say, God, I need you. The song we're going to sing is about the goodness of God. God is faithful and just, and He will forgive us of our sins, and He will cleanse us from those things, and He will restore you, and He will help you live a life without anger. Let's stand.
I love you, Lord. Oh, your mercy never fails me. And all my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, I will sing of the goodness. All my life you have been faithful.
Father, we thank you that you have been faithful. Father, we thank you that you will continue to be faithful in our hearts, in our lives. God, we just pray that you would help us to take your word and to apply it, that we would not just merely listen and walk away and say, oh, that was good, but God, that we would do what you ask us to do, that we would trust you with our anger. God, that we would trust you with our lives. And we know that we ask you this all the time, but God, we just want others to see you living through us. And we ask these things in Jesus' precious name.